Hello, welcome to Cool and/or Uncool Things. We're going to get more serious today with a recommendation and analysis, rather light analysis, of the Iliad, the single greatest work of secular literature of all time. The Iliad deals with 2 weeks during the 10th year of the Trojan War. Most people, when they haven't read the Iliad before, and they begin reading it, they're very confused as to how it starts. It begins in medias res. Most epics begin in the... Actually, the definition of epic is that it begins in the middle of a work. That's the classical Greek definition of an epic, as well as the meter that it has since changed. But the Iliad begins very late in the war, and it deals with only 2 weeks. It is not about the totality of the war, it is about two characters, Achilles and Hector. And almost everything that could be said about human existence is said in the Iliad. It comes from a pre-literate society. Greece had writing with linear B. It had forgot it during the Greek Dark Ages. 90% of the population of mainland Greece died roughly a decade or two, after a generation or two after the Trojan War, and would then adopt Phoenician lettering afterwards. But it comes from a pre-literate society, or yes, an inter-literate society, and therefore everything could be subject culture that had to be, or all cultural mores, all religious and cultural, secular, and ethical documents had to be preserved in storytelling. It's a great work, not because it has the luxury of being a great work. It is a great work because it has the cultural necessity of being a great work. The main character of the Iliad is Achilles. Achilles is the strongest, bravest, noblest, and youngest warrior of the Greeks in the Trojan War. There is, in other poems, a younger character named Neoptolemus, or Pyrrhus, who is Achilles' son. But in the Iliad, he is one of the younger Achaeans. The oldest is named Nestor. The other main character is Hector, who is the crown prince of Troy. Achilles is, in some ways, superhuman, and in other ways, entirely subhuman. He has effectively three relationships he cares about. One is his Greek of course he's Greek. One is his godmother, Thetis. The second one is his best friend, not lover. That theory has no real foundation in the work. It began in Athens hundreds of years after this was written. Patroclus. And lastly, his concubine, Briseis, who he actually is quite deeply in love with. Hector, on the other hand, is the seminal human being of the work. He is seen in relationship with his son, his wife, his father, his people, and the men he leads. He is considered kind of the quintessential man. To the Greeks, you would have been considered more human or less human based on how many relationships you had with people. Not romantic, but I mean like just how involved you were in as many spheres of life as you could be. Achilles forgoes all those things. But I'm just going to break down the plot very quickly. I've kind of gone ahead of myself, as is the part of the course with these videos. It begins in the 10th year of the war. There is a plague in the Greek ranks. Agamemnon, who is the commander-in-chief of the Greeks, has taken a concubine for himself, Chryseis, who's the daughter of Chryses. Chryses is a priest of Apollo, and he's terribly, terribly sad that his daughter is gone and being held captive by a man. He prays to Apollo to cause a plague in the Greek ranks. Apollo does that. Agamemnon is forced to let go of Chryseis, and because he's been having problems with Agamemnon, he takes Briseis, who's Achilles, sorry, because he had problems with Achilles and Agamemnon, because who's Achilles' concubine. This, in addition to being like horribly sexist and a sexual affront to Achilles, is in some ways an attempt to steal Achilles' afterlife. There are two main words you need to understand to really kind of get the essence of the Iliad and the ethos of the people inside. Timē, which means honor, kind of. It does not mean honor in the sense that we think about honor as far as an internal concept of heroic morality, which we show forth in action. It is the physical manifestations of the acts of heroism that you have. It's essentially booty. And the other one is kleos, which is actually related to the English word to call. Kleos is what people say about you. It means glory or fame, kind of. These are both external concepts. It takes place in what's called a shame society, where social mores are governed by external forces as opposed to cultured internal forces. And because they're external, they are removable. When Achilles loses Briseis, he's losing his kleos and his timē. The reason why you want kleos is because the afterlife in Homer is very, very vague, almost non-existent. People are looking for this thing called kleos, aptheon, or everlasting glory, in the Iliad. That's how people remember them. That is the closest thing to any meaningful afterlife they will ever have. So, in addition to a sexual affront, Agamemnon is shaming his greatest soldier by trying to steal his afterlife, which is not appropriate. Achilles retires from the Greek ranks and is in his tent for the majority of the work. While that happens, he says that he won't return until he actually threatens to leave for a while. He's coaxed into staying and possibly returning if the Greek ships are set on fire. That later happens. When that happens, his best friend Patroclus wears his armor to scare the Trojans and gets killed by Hector. Hector, once again, is a crown prince of the Trojans and their greatest warrior. He is roughly the strength of the second two great warriors in the Achaeans, Ajax or Ajax and Diomedes. Another key plot point slash term you should know is Aristeia. Aristeia is the scene in the work where someone has their best moment of fighting. It could last a long time. Hector's Aristeia lasts several books. It could last a relatively short time. Agamemnon and Patroclus both have Aristeias, as does Diomedes. And they're more subdued. I say subdued, but Diomedes enters a god. in his. But they're looking for the memory to be preserved in this form of song. The work is in some ways self-referential. It understands the own logic of its composition. Heck, Achilles is called out to combat. He is given Briseis, but he doesn't have any interest in sleeping with her. He doesn't have any interest in eating, any interest in drinking, or any normal human or animal function. He only really cares about killing. And this is the point where his status as both what humans could be if they achieved extreme metaphysical heights is shown, but is also inherently linked to humans showing extreme metaphysical depths. He basically is a god at this point. He's also lower than animals. Hector has family. Hector eats and drinks with his men. He partakes in physical aspects of life. Achilles relegates himself only physical aspects of life when it involves slaughter. He dwells largely in his own head. He is very Byronic by nature. The work ends with Achilles killing Hector, desecrating his body, mourning for Patroclus, but he doesn't find any joy in it. He sacrifices 12 Trojan boys on his best friend's funeral pyre. But he begins to realize that there's effectively no justice in this world, and you can't bring your friends back. Which sounds kind of like someone learning that their dog is dead and they're gonna see it again. It's not what it is, it's much richer than that. And Priam, the king of Troy, comes to ransom his body, his son's body, from Achilles. And the work ends largely with those two mourning about the futility of war and the futility of existence, but also that they can find glory in it and that it has meaning despite being futile. And Hector's body being buried. The central themes of the work are once again what it means to be human, what is life, what is worth living for. And you see this in multiple dimensions. I have said that Achilles is both superior to humans and inferior to humans at the same time, and intrinsically, he is both. That is true and is for parts of the work, the most important parts of the work. He also begins as human and returns to human by the end of the work. This is one of the reasons why I like the work, the movie Drive, so well. Drive also has this theme of tearing humanity away from someone, experiment, viewing how they work. And reconstructing them. And what is amazing about the Iliad is that it is these incredibly, incredibly dark and existential themes. But it's always been a very populist work. The work is about rage. It's about how we comport ourselves to life. If you are interested in, I think I'm going to end my analysis there. I could probably go on to talk about this work for, I could very easily go into work, go and talk about this piece of literature for many, many more hours. But I'd probably prefer to do that in more organized. And I might do that later. We'll see if I do like a multiple video series of this. If you want to learn more about the Iliad, the Odyssey is fine. The Odyssey largely deals with themes of family and homecoming, and for me, you see more of the human condition when you kind of stress treat it with violence and trauma. Which there is plenty of in the Odyssey, but I find the Odyssey a bit more of a limp work. If you're curious about learning more about the Iliad, I would very heavily recommend The Great Courses by Elizabeth Vandiver. You can get them on Audible. They're one credit, they're like $15. They are life-changing courses, and this is a life-changing work. If you've never read it, please do. I implore you. All right, this has been Cool and Uncool Things. I'm still finding my voice with these things. I should really have more of a kind of outline. I will with the Silmarillion, probably, and doing other things. Probably gonna do a few album reviews next, just because there are lots of them that just fall on the radar, and that's pointless. I will probably do a more cohesive treatment of the Iliad, possibly even going book by book in it. We'll see. If you would like that, please comment on this YouTube video. That'd be fantastic. Like and subscribe. That'd be great. All right, see you guys next time.